The Vieja
Aquarium, more specifically the Vieja Sinspillum. Five beautiful cichlids that are all bostrous and potentially have two pairs in that aquarium. Looking like we have two males and three females. I need to scape this aquarium, but I face a challenge. One, we have cichlids that are going to get relatively large. We've got fish that are going to dig up the substrate, so no matter what I do, so plants in the substrate are a no-go. We have fish that are going to terrorize and rip plants apart, so if I do use plants, we need to have plants that can survive that sort of punishment. We have fish that are gonna move the decorations. We have fish that are gonna do whatever they want in that tank, but boy, are they beautiful. This story, once again, starts outside when you guys will remember I took you back in the shed and showed you my wood. You'll remember that massive centerpiece that we used. We cut it in half. We used half of it in the Walru tank. It looks absolutely stunning. I think many of you will agree. And then we took that other half. I kicked it aside because I didn't think I was going to use it. And then I realized if it stood up, that is a beautiful centerpiece type decoration where it stands up and it kind of looks like tree roots in the ground growing out. I figured maybe we could take that, cover it in a bunch of plants, tie them down, and that could be the main center focus of that aquarium. Something natural, something beautiful, yet something purposeful in that tank. Let me explain. Let's start with the plants. I first went with that Java moss that we had previously, and that is actually weeping moss. This is a beautiful moss and I had a lot of it, but a lot of it was kind of dried out. It seems like it was pretty old and I didn't have much hope for it. I went with the method of simply using some cotton sewing thread, which dissolves in the water over time. And you guys will remember we did this to the 375, tied it onto the branches, and it looked absolutely amazing. It grew in and it became lush. But the stuff that was really dried out, I decided I'm just gonna coat that one piece of the wood in that and see what happens over time, because I thought, one, it's gonna come loose and just float up. It's not going to survive. The fish will rip it apart. We'll see what happens. And just in case, I took a few more clumps and put them sparingly throughout the rest of the wood, just simply tying them onto that wood once again. This is a tried and true method. You could use, of course, crazy glue, but I didn't want to use a bunch of glue because I didn't know if this was going to work out in the first place. And I had an awful lot of moss and no glue. The key to doing this and to have the most success is to keep this wet. You can use a water spray bottle or sprinkle some water over top of the moss just to mat it down and make it more malleable. Otherwise, it's just going to dry out incredibly fast. Believe it or not, this might take you about 20 minutes to do. And over those 20 minutes, the moss can potentially dry out. Now, over time, what I see happening here is the moss simply taking over that piece of wood. And I think it's going to look absolutely beautiful if that happens. But I only had one half of the wood covered. I decided I'd take a couple more mats of that Java fern, which I was floating in the tank just to test out, see what they would do with it. They left it alone, so I figured, well, I'm going to cut those into four pieces and stuff it into the crevices of the wood. Over time, both the moss as well as this Java fern is going to root onto the wood. That's the beauty of plants like ferns and like the Java ferns and the mosses and of course the Anubias. They don't need a planted tank substrate per se. So I drained the tank on purpose. I wanted to make sure that I can corral the fish wherever I needed them to go. Plus, when I'm lowering the wood in, they don't have the opportunity to freak out and smash into the wood. They're all gonna be on one side and it worked out pretty well. Now the piece of wood in here once again looks relatively big, but at its deepest point it's about 8 inches wide and at its narrowest point just a couple of inches, but it does go the entire height of the tank. I decided I'd place this more to the left of the tank and kind of angled outwards just to give it a more of an appeal, but I'm also considering the activity of the actual fish and what they're going to need. Obviously, they need to be able to swim behind the wood. They also need to have visual blocks. Again, we have two pairs in this tank potentially, and I want to be able to accommodate both of them and see what happens. But these guys aren't really going to be glass layers. Like a lot of fish will lay their eggs on the side of a glass if they lay adhesive eggs. Others might lay them on rocks and even your heater. Discus are horrible for that. And then of course, others like to dig out a place in the substrate and lay their eggs on the glass there, and they have all those options, but I did want to offer them opportunities for having rocks to actually lay their eggs on, and even though not smooth, they do have that instinct to clean them off and lay. So I wasn't looking to make anything with these fake rocks, and that's what they are, they're hollow rocks, which is great because I can move them super easy. And if I ever wanted to, I could take them out and artificially raise the fry if that were the case. But I made sure that there was three sections of rocks, one on the left side of the wood, one underneath of it, and a couple on the far right side. And what this should do is, each placement of these rocks is actually within the visual breaks. So on one side of the rock, if you're at the left side, you can't actually see, if you're the fish, of course, the middle rock. Or if you're at the middle rock, you can't see either other sides, and of course on the right. So these are all planned out, and this is all necessary. It becomes extremely difficult to plan a scape around fish with specific needs, but it's not necessarily too difficult if you just get creative and truly just understand what they want. And then of course I started to fill the tank back up, shut the lights off, and I was thinking, you know what, they're gonna destroy the plants, everything's gonna look horrible. But the very next day I came out, they were interacting with the scape. The plants are all still intact, none of them were floating, they left them completely alone. They rearranged the substrate slightly, but we're utilizing the three visual points and the visual blocks. Now, I don't think this is the best scape ever, but I do think that it is natural looking. I also think the plants do add some greenery and a lush effect to it, but most importantly, the fish are enjoying it, and it's what I think they need the most. As of today, let's have a look, which is 48 hours later. So the moss is kind of starting to loosen up and stand up a little bit. The ferns are looking good. They're not wilting away or anything like that. But if we look over here, we've got a pair. That's the male, the female. And then this is the other male over in the dark area, so to speak. And then this is a female and this is a female. So I'm not sure which female he's going to take down, but these two have been mated and paired up since a while ago. Now, if you look at the substrate one, we've got this rock back here, the substrate's dug out, they put it on top of the rock, wherever they want. But if we look from this angle, see how wide the wood is? That's a fantastic visual block. The fish can go there, they can't see the others, nobody can see them, they can do their business over here. The middle one, same thing, can't see that rock, and you couldn't see this rock over here, of course, if you were in the tank. But then a couple more rocks out here. This rock was kind of placed right here just to hide the end, the butt end of that wood there, because as you can see, it's like cut off. But the moss over time will cover it. They did take some of the substrate and dig it up and spit it on top of the moss. I'm gonna leave it, it's their tank. We'll see what happens. They've been moving the substrate around, as you can see, burying it, doing as they please. I think over time, as the plants grow in, it's gonna look phenomenal. Now, of course, the background is lighter than this and it does kind of clash, but I actually enjoy the contrast. What I like the most about this scape and that scape and all the ones that we've been doing is they're so dramatically different. Yes, we are using some very similar plants to other tanks, but none of these tanks look the same. And the fish are just absolutely fascinating. Right over here, we got some tiny fish, and then of course we got these big guys. Eventually they'll be breeding. These guys will be breeding. We're gonna work on this planted tank soon. The Walrus are doing fantastic. We still gotta do that tank. I have a fantastic idea for that. We've got Susan, which I need to finish her tank. And then we've got this little fellow over here with tons of activity. All tanks, none of them look the same. And then of course we got the 2000 with the lights off, but nothing compares to that. And then we have what's going on out there. Ultimately though, I think it's been a fantastic aquarium to work on. I certainly do appreciate and like a challenge like that where you have to actually create something for the fish instead of something that's visually pleasing for us. I'm a fish keeper more so than a aquarium keeper. I like the fish more than I like anything, so their world revolves around them and I make sure that I can accommodate everything that they want. This tank is just absolutely awesome. It's so distracting though. And Susan's looking at these guys like they're a snack. Anyways, guys, I hope you enjoyed today's video. I hope you enjoy the new Vieja tank. I know I personally do. I used to love having a simple centerpiece or a simple, you know, showpiece ornament within the aquarium, and it just simply completes it because it's one of a kind and nobody has that exact piece of wood. If you have something like that, or if you had better ideas of something I could have did with a fish that's going to tear the tank apart pretty much no matter what you do, let me know in the comment section below. I'd also love to know if you like the tank and what you think we're going to do with one of the final tanks on the end. Hope you enjoyed today's video. If you're not subscribed to this channel yet and you want to make sure that you don't see, if you don't want to miss any of these videos, make sure you subscribe. Say, what? God, stop.